Hey, you guys! We are back here again with Sryth, our text-based fantasy game. So last time we finished up the proving grounds, I guess, right? So now we're sort of, I feel more free to start my adventure from the beginning. And do some of that. So that's what I'm gonna do. What I wanna do, though, besides that, is... I got a notepad tally here about things I want to do or need to do, so I'm going to keep that up. Can you see it? No. I was like, no way you could see it, because this is taking this screen only. So yeah, I finished Proving Grounds 5, got Shadow Magic, which is what main point of that is. I could do Proving Grounds 4 to get Troll Bonnet. Not really super interested in doing that right now. We will do that eventually. We're going to do all the Proving Grounds at some point. Yes, it'll be a very long series because I've never done everything in this game. It is so full. But what I want to do, I brought my house, so I'm going to go there first so I can renovate. Keep renovating until it has enough grandeur for me to start doing stuff with it. And keep my encumbrance down. I think I'm okay at 36%. So I'm gonna just leave that at that. I like that it's called Apple River Castle. I like that name. So what I wanna do is go to Western Tisa. No, Southwest Tisa, back to Hawklor. So Hawklor is where you start the game, and I went off on a little tangent to get all the powers I can get. Well, I got all the powers, and to get all the, as much skills as I can get, which I've done. And I'm pretty sure I'm out of experience now. Oh no, I could do one. I'm using the slashing weapon. Let's see about powers. Yeah, we could do like one. High level shadow magic and restoration. I'm thinking do telekinesis. So yeah, is there anything else that I have enough on to train? There is not. So yeah, I went on a tangent to get all the powers I can get and all the skills I can get, besides all the weaponry skills is what I'm missing. We have the blue door, besides getting my daily bonus, which is not gonna let me do something else. I can also show you, if I go to stored, it'll tell you what's left, which is Troll Bomb and Lances. Is all this other skills and powers left that I need to get. So I'm not gonna worry about it, but I did get enough to train in something else. I think I want to do archery, just cause I'm dope like that and I'm the best archer there is. Okay, I'm not the best archer, I'm the number 10 archer there is. Hey, but I'm number 7 in weaponry, so we're in the top 10. We're in the top 10. Alright. So we're back in Hawklor. So what I want to do is just, I'm a new hero. I'm a new adventurer. I want to help people and thrive in this world and help other people thrive in this world. So that's my goal and my call to action here is to be a good hero adventurer and just help people. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to visit everybody just to see if we can talk to somebody and get a quest, maybe, so you can distract the conversation here.
If I had time to talk, I could tell you quite a few tales. What's piling up around me as it is, though, we'll have to talk some other time if you don't mind.
What about that long scar in your chin?
Long look of pain passes over the blacksmith's face, and it takes several seconds for him to compose himself enough to reply. Don't rightly know. I was hunting up near Westwold a year ago or so, when I was in my new home. I was on my way home after dark, when something jumped in the forest. I didn't get a right good look at it, but whatever it was small but strong. I tried to cut my throat with some kind of knife. Anyway, it only got my chin before I held it into the bushes. I'd wager my smithy on the notion it was a goblin. Folks have been seeing them up that way, or so they say. What do you know about Westwall? He'll tell you that Westwall is the area of forest about 3 miles outside of Hawklor to the northwest. He tells you that to get there, you need to leave the village proper and cross the bridge. I'd be careful going up that way. Yes, if you go, but it takes an army with you, and you've got plenty of that, he'll suit ya. Mind ya. Alright, I won't make him talk anymore. He doesn't want to talk. So there's goblins around in Westworld. Let's hit the tavern. The Stoneback Tavern is a likeness of a large and particularly ugly stoneback spider emblazed on its front set of double doors. The tavern is quite large inside and rather well kept. A large hand-painted sign adorns the wall just inside the front doors. A village the size of Hawklor surprises a large number of people hanging about inside the tavern. The tavern keepers a robust, jovial fellow named Piripor comes out and welcomes you. Tells you that should you need anything, just let him know. Let's talk to him. Piripor laughs heartily while informing you of the many comers and goers in the folk of Hawklor. Piripor tells you that he wishes the king of Tisa would send an army to deal with Honey Jack. He explains to you that Honey Jack is a mountain giant that has demanded tribute from the local towns and villages for nearly a generation, in exchange for not flattering them. This is the amount of tribute that has grown in recent years and is getting to be a nearly unbearable sum. Well, I don't suppose there are many with the might or courage to stand up to old Honey Jack and his sons. What about him? Pippa goes on a rather long-winded account of the mountain giant Honey Jack. You learn that Honey Jack has been an unpleasant fiction in this part of Western Tisa for almost a generation. And before you appear in the area just over 50 years ago, it was commonly believed the race of mountain giants had been a thing of legend. At first, Honey Jack won praise for the local towns and villages when he single-handedly, literally, defeated a wicked dust dragon known as Quanzol by throttling the creature to death. Quanzol, an old and powerful dust dragon, has been demanding tribute to the local towns and villages in exchange for providing protection to the entire area. Quanzol did little protecting, however, and last number of missing people were in tribute to the dragon. After killing Quanzol, Hunter Jack and his two sons, Sed Jack and Hin Jack, moved into the dragon's cave and began demanding tribute of their own from the locals. This tribute was paid without question, for who would dare defy a giant who had single-handedly strangled a powerful dust dragon? Literally. Hunter Jack proved to be somewhat more tolerable than his predecessor, for although he did not actually protect him, the populace did not interfere with their affairs, as Quanzol had done from time to time. However, over the years, the amount of pain he now has continued to grow. Learn that many a bold soul has confronted the giant, but his sons over the years either attempted to drive away or slay him. They have all, without exception, met a certain doom. A few years back, a troop of Tissian border rangers, numbered at least 12, disappeared after attempting to forcibly remove the three giants from the area. Learn that Honey Jack stands just over 20 feet tall and is said to have the strength of 100 men. His sons, Sed Jack and Hin Jack, are considerably smaller, each standing just over 10 feet tall. From what you've heard, you get the feeling that locals have come to accept Honey Jack and his tribute demands as a fact of life. But the fact that the mountain giant has no mate is a sliver of hope, at least there won't be any more mountain giants to contend with. You learn that the cave of Honey Jack is located in the west of Hawklor, somewhere in the foothills of Felrondin Range. Continue. Piripor hardly lasts one for me. Okay, it's the same conversation. Let's read the sign. You carefully read the hand-painted sign just inside the front door. Feeling brave and hardy? Have a taste for finer brew? Let old Piripor serve up a mother hammer tongue for you. Anyone sat enough to down the entire flagon of my special brew and retain their wits will win a prize. Come and see Piripor if you're up to it. Okay, sure. Your poor face lights up when he tells you that you prepared to accept the challenge of downing a mug of his special hammer tongue brew. Mug, did you say? He says, seemingly distressed by the word. Yes. Well, you see, actually, it's a flagon, a rather large flagon, if you like this one. The tavern keeper draws out a very sizable flagon and holds it proudly in front of him for you to examine. This would be a large flagon for a normal brew. It's all right if you rather back down, he says. I would understand. I don't back down. It doesn't matter what the prize is. Piripor's smile broadens until you think it's about to spread off his face. The tavern keeper puts down the flagon and rubs his hands together fervently. And without warning, he raises his fist, laughs heartily, and shouts, almost feverishly, getting the attention of everyone seated in the common room. Let us see what Alison the Brave is truly made of, he grins. Every head in the place turns to face you, and before you can react, you're mauled by no less than everyone of the 24 tavern patrons, each of them slapping your back. and cheering you on, generally making quite a racket. Pierpont clears the crowd and proceeds to lead you over to one of the tables on the tavern floor. Once you're seated, he disappears through the doorway in the far wall, and in a few moments returns holding a frothy flag and proudly in front of you. Sets flagging down in front of you and stands back with his arms crossed, and the other tavern patrons gathered around the table. Pierpont lays out the rules of the contest for all to hear. You're to swallow every drop of the hammerdown, including the foam, he said sternly. If you manage to make it through that, you're to stand up from the table, climb into the chair, and hold that spot for a minute. The brew is strong and works very quickly, and if you're ready, Alison, and good luck, you'll certainly need it. Every eye in the stone-backed tavern is fixed on you with a slight bit of trepidation. You grasp the flag in hand and begin its frothy contest towards your mouth. Your lips are about to touch the foam, but you shout from the crowd side of you. Don't drink it, Alison, shrieks the voice. It's poison. He's trying to kill you. At once every head in the tavern turns face the source of the voice, a small, frail, elderly man shrieks back sheepishly under the glare of the annoyed patrons. Pierpont frowns and makes hastily toward the old man. Go on, cast off out of here. Hibrag. Before Pierpont can reach the old man, he stumbled out of the tavern and onto the street. Don't you pay him no mind, Alison, says Pierpont apologetically. His real nuisance, that one, ain't the drink, mind you, it's his head. He's as bad as they come. As the others in the crowd nod in agreement, still it remains your decision. Of course it's my decision. Let's go. The moment the first of the thick, creamy ales reaches your mouth, you realize you're in for it. It may not be poison, but it is without doubt the strongest brew you've ever had, the displeasure of tasting. The warm taste you can take large gulps of the potent drink. Success! With only a slight degree of difficulty, you manage to dunk the entire contents of the flagon, including the foam. Then, you suddenly flagon down to the table, and as instructed, take up a standing position at the top of your chair. The contest is not officially over until 1 minute has passed, but the moment you step onto the chair, the entire tavern erupts with cheers. Pierpont is smiling along with the rest of them, but you sense he's not nearly as happy as the others. Finally, Pierpont pulls you down from the chair and slaps you on the back. Well done, Alison, he bellows. Let's have a cheer for our schoolmaster. The page was erupt at once more, the chorus of voices reaching an almost deafening level. Pierpont strides out of the common room into the back room of the tavern. He returns moments later with your prize. That's the prize, this junk. Pierpont has brought you with a large glass of his infamous, although not likely to be slightly less than infamous, hammer tongue brew. Pierpont pulls you aside away from the other patron and speaks to you in low tone. He tells you that his cousin, a local huntsman by the name of Boomer, lives in the outskirts of the village in a small cabin, that he has a second part of your prize. He tells you that he didn't want to say anything in front of the other folks of the valley of the nature of the second part of the prize. He gets you his cousin's cabin and tells you to leave the village, cross the bridge to the west, and take a right and fork in the road. He also congratulates you one more time. So I'm at tavern. Okay, we already read that. We already read the sign. Moving on, mate. Come on, room. There's a rather sizable cabin at Stoneback Tavern. We pass several tables until you happen upon a rugged-looking crew of four men. One of the men makes a loud, off-color remark about you to his companions, and all four men share a good laugh at your expense. A few of the tavern patrons have heard the comment and are sniggering quietly. When you respond with a rather witty retort, the table goes quiet, and the man who made the original comment glares at Jim's face, turning a brilliant shade of crimson. You had best apologize for that, he grumbles.
Nah.
The man's face goes even redder, and his entire body begins to shake. He rises from the table, his handkerchief to the hilt of his longsword strapped to his side. You assume a defensive stand, ready for the possible attack he might launch. You wish you would swallow your pride, strangers. My pride? Who started this? Suddenly, Pierpont, the tavern keeper, rushes over and puts his opportunity in the man. I have none of this in here, he snaps. You both best mind yourselves, or I'll have a mixture come round you up. The man grovels something and signals other three men to stand up. All three rise to his side, their hands resting on the hilts of their short swords. Call on anyone you like, he says, shoving Pierpont to the side. I'll have this stranger's blood before I'm insulted like that again. By hesitation, he draws his weapon and attacks. To his dismay, his three cohorts follow suit. Okay, left in the corner with the four tavern roughnecks. Alright, I haven't killed him. I'm a good person. Finish it. The last one topples over. He's been knocked utterly senseless by your savage, well-placed blow, but like his cohorts, he'll eventually recover. The tavern crowd sits in stunned silence. You quickly stoop, examine the bodies, you discover the following. I mean, you can sell it, I guess. They don't deserve to have it. The front doors of the tavern burst open, and several members of the local militia stride in, their weapons drawn and their gaze fixed firmly on you. People immediately explain the situation to them, and accept his word, although they appear to regard you with a bit of caution. People thank you for saving the skin, seems to regard that the men were only interested in harming you, and bustles off to calm the jungle nerves of his patients with free ale. The militiamen do work of dragging out the senseless forms of four roughnecks, and they kindly ask you to let them handle all matters of the station in the future if possible. Nice job at that, remarks one of the militiamen and specifies. This crew's in a bit of trouble, you know? Maybe they'll finally be taught a lesson they can understand. It takes a little while, but after a couple of rounds of free drinks, people firmly draws a line. That two percussmen, tavern mob, seems to have come back to life somewhat. The tavern mob seems to have come back to life somewhat. Alright, that's all we got here. I'll go back to the mercantile and sell my stuff. This junk. I might need it for something. Trots corn. Oh, wait, we're gonna have it. I don't know what I'm supposed to do with that. Here's some of these things. Please and thank you. And I'm gonna go back. Alright, who else? Visit the Hillsfeet Inn. The Hillsfeet Inn is all but deserted. Its keeper, a slender one-eyed woman named Jinda, smiles at you while going about her daily chores. Two men are seated at a table in Ian's corner and going over a map. One of the men is rather rotund and dressed in exotic silks. The other seems less refined and by his lights appear to be quite a rugged individual. Let's talk to Jinda. I don't have time to talk this minute, huffs Jinda as she busies herself to yet another task. But in the end, it's quite time consuming, you know? You ought to have a go at it sometime. Nah, I'm good. Let's talk to two men. You approach two men to get the table and engage in a conversation. The large man introduces himself as Terrid, and the other man said in essence is Nimbo. The large man explains that his mansion is to move a wagon load of cloth to the city of Trithic and north. He tells you that going north to Trithic has become a dangerous place of late, and he's seeking to hire a couple of guards for the journey. I've already got Nimbo here, he says, but the trouble that has been lately about the roads, I can use another. You look like you're good in a pinch. I'll tell you what, I can pay you 20 gold tokens when you arrive in Trithic if you so on the trip. What do you say? Sure. Tyrion jumps up from the table and glee when he accepts his offer, and he and Nindo set about preparing the wagon for the journey. Leave immediately, says Tyrion. Terrid, as he leads some provisions back into the back of the covered wagon. That way, you can get in, be in Trithic in 3 days' time or less. And now you begin to journey north out of Hawklor, seizing the front of the wagon with Terrid, who's driving, Nindo, who seems ever watchful of anything and everything. As you travel, you learn that Nindo met up with Terrid in the city of Galdrak 7 months back and has been in his employ as a guard ever since. The first 2 days of the journey go smoothly, but at dawn on the third day of travel, you're confronted with the real danger of the trek. The wagon starts to halt as 5 armed men with axes and wooden clubs step out into the road to block the way. Terrid whispers to you that the wagon is much too late and that you can sit outright with them along the road. Give us a wagon and we'll spare your lives, said the bold leader of the 5 men. And Terrid refuses. They demand as the 5 men search for an attack, you're booted. The high muscles about to put to his first S. Nindo draws his long sword and leaps to intercept the men before they reach the wagon. Terry cavils in the buckboard. Fight! Quick combat, death to the heathens. Huh, I knew I picked the right person for the job, exclaims Terry. He and Nindo pick over the dead bandits and discover some items that may be of use. You may take any of the following items. You help Nindo clear the bodies of the road before continuing the journey north. The rest of the journey to Trithic passes without incident. Upon reaching Trithic, Terrid leaves you with agreed upon and then pushes your coach ticket back to Hawklor. You accept your 20 gold tokens after which you board the coach and several other points out. Well, at least you shouldn't have any more trouble. The bandits, unless there's more of that ill-glugging about. Anyway, you can handle on shore, Allison. Yes, that's true. The ghost arrives in Hawklor 2 days later, you disembark. It took us 3 days to get there and 2 days to get back. Alright, so maybe we got some more stuff to sell to you. The mice and wolves in the darkest day. Village Council Building. The Village Council Building doubles as a headquarters for Hawklor's small welfare militia. The structure consists of a single large room furnished with a rickety wooden table, which has gathered a dozen chairs, each in a comparable state of repair. Then disrepair. There's no sign of anyone in or around the building. Where are they? Alright, let's hit the stables. Fire was running ahead in the Hawklor stables. Many of the stalls are empty, perhaps because the work horses are busy in the fields outside the village. The young boy with the tangled mop of brown hair is busy cleaning the stalls. Yo. Paul tells you there are few and few horses around Hawklor these days, as so many have been disappearing up the fields. Oh, they say it's goblins, he said excitedly, but who knows? You have any more? Mr. Evenham informs you that no horses for sale right now. We do get one once in a great while, though, so if you stop back by a bit, maybe something will have come up. Okay, let's take a look around. In a quick examination of the stables and discover nothing that merits the interest, you're about to abandon your search when suddenly your eye catches sight of a wooden hatchway set in the floor and the back room into the store. It's half buried in a polished job unless it's recently opened. Make your way over to the hatch and the slimmer hand rushes over and puts himself between you and your goal. He holds his rusty pitchfork in front of you in a defensive manner as he attempts to bar your progress. Can't you go near there, miss? He says to him. But I'm trying to keep everyone out. What's down there? Nothing. There's nothing down there, he said. He's a bit flustered. Now please, miss, just be on your business and let's forget about it, alright? Move aside. And then the stable hand makes half a harder attempt to block your advance in there. Handle the pitchfork. You, however, are having no part of his antics. You grasp the handle of his makeshift weapon with both hands and give it a rather violent twist, sending him flying into a pile of hay in the inside of the stall. You toss the pitchfork aside, flash your wide grin, and continue toward the hatch. You pull open the hatch and are confronted by a rickety wooden ladder that descends about 12 feet to the dirt floor of the cellar beneath the stables. You carefully descend the wobbly ladder and you're just about to set foot in the dirt floor of the cellar with the sharp edge of your blow punching against the base of your skull. One sudden movement of you, alas, said a man's voice from behind you. Turn around, slowly, says the voice, and as the blade is drawn back from the base of your skull, you carefully follow the treasure and find yourself face to face with a tall, lanky man with raven locks that fall about his shoulders. He regards you with air of caution, still holding a bag at the ready. Who are you? Name's Allison. Never met an Allison I liked, he smiles. Well met. He sheaths his dagger and extends his hand palm outward, trying to initiate his shoulder cross. All right. The man standing before you introduced himself as Helene. I'll tell you what, Allison, he says, looking over you over the caution. You look the sort of person someone can in trouble could trust. Would you like to make 50 gold? If you say yes, we're in business. What do you say? Okay. Helene tells you that he arrived in Hawklor last night and has since been hiding out here beneath the stables. I've been running for 2 weeks now, he says, his eyes studying you closely. I have some very bad people after me, Allison. Doing all they can to make sure I never reach Trithic alive, and I have every reason to believe they will follow my trail to this village. Helen pauses momentarily as a hastily attempts to movement in the stables above. I swore in the simple hand to at least give me a warning that someone's coming. It's most. Now that I have asked, now what I have asked you puts you in no danger, but it would be a great help to me. All you have to do is make 50 gold. There are several voices in the same way, but of course, Helene takes false out, he says, back as a shadow's motion to follow suit. After listening for only a few moments, Helene tells you, that's them. This is I'm certain of it. His eyes remain trained on an open hatch at the top of the ladder. You can hear voices at least 2 minutes they speak in the same hand, however, you cannot make out what they say. Here, Allison, take this. This was Helene. He hands you a dagger-sized object tucked into a deerskin bag. Take this and keep it safe. It's very valuable, but don't sell it. Bring it to Trithic, and I'll meet up with you at Nard Otter. It's an alehouse down by the river docks. I'll give you 50 gold now, and 100 when I meet you at the Otter. But don't show up with a man called Shrill. He then hands you 50 gold tokens. The voice above suddenly sounds as if they're right above the open hatchway. There's a back way out of here. This was Helene. Hurriedly pointing at the far corner of the cellar where a half-rotted door is set with a mouldy wall. Take it and be gone. I will lead them away from here. They'll still think that I have what I just gave you, and it's much more than never get your hands up. They never get their hands up. You'll be in no danger if you leave now before they see you. Helene motions to the rotted door and moves himself to a position behind the rickety ladder, leaning up through the open hatch. A large shadow spills from the hatch and it falls over the rungs of the ladder. The people above are standing directly up the opening. Okay. Race the door and pull it over, revealing a set of narrow steps that ascends into daylight. The last thing you see before climbing the steps is giving the sailors fully nodding his approval at you from his hiding spot behind the ladder. You emerge from the dark cellar in daylight and quickly move away from the stables. When you save this in a way, you retrieve the skin bag from the possession open to reveal this content. Inside your shot, the funny kiss is a large, black, razor-sharp, bony tail spike of a horn tail. Fully aware that the possession of a horn tail horn is grounds for sentence of death in several North Bradland nations, including Tisa, you quickly set the object back inside the deerskin bag. Without further delay, you make your way hastily toward the center of the village. You do not begin to feel at ease again until you reach the tall hawk statue in the center of Hawklor. Alright. Sounds to me that we need to get this thing out of here. Now, I do not want to hold on to it. So before I continue exploration, I'm going to travel to Sryth, which is western. Is it Sryth? We're going to explore the city. We're going to go to the river dogs. Gnarled Otter. Gnarled Otter Hale House is an eyesore from the inside out. Broken furniture lies heaped in the corners, and the long tables and benches that provide seating for the motley assortment of patrons are in an advanced state of disrepair, and a large wood sculpture of the grinning otter stands against the far wall and appears to be the only bit of decor still in fairly good shape. An imposing woman, a lone expression, seemingly a frozen scowl, shows flagons of ale before and behind a table at the rear of the room. Let's buy an ale. You stride up to the table in the back of the tavern, offer a quick greeting to the frowning woman serving the ale. She rolls her eyes and immediately shows a frothing tankard at you. The ale is thin and mostly tasteless. Beneath the froth, a less than appealing oily sheen hugs the surface of the brownish liquid. Take less than 3 sips and the crude serving woman edges your arm and cocks her in the direction of one of the long stables. You follow her gaze and note a good 5 men drink ale afar, one of the men staring directly at you. Somebody's interested in you, she grumbles. Mind yourself with that crew, though. That business will run. What's up? The men all look up at you as you approach the table. The one who is staring at you rises and bows courteously. Perhaps we can all go somewhere a bit more private and talk, he says, his voice trailing away in a whisper as he speaks. What's this about? This matter we cannot discuss here. There are too many ears about in this wretched place. It would be well worth your while to come with us. All right. I may lead you out of the gnarled altar and the long river up to a short, half-rotted wooden building. The man who greeted you at the ale house unlocks the door and measures everyone inside. You step into a small, windowless room. A lantern sits in the corner of the room, casting a pale glow over the sparse interior. The door is closed. What's the last man who waited for you, Allison? So the man who initially greets you as he turns around to face you. I believe you carry something you greatly desire. The man introduces himself as Shrill and tells you that he's a good friend of Helen. Sadly, Helen has disappeared. You returned to the city just recently and no one knows where he's going to. But he told me you were arriving with what he gave you in confidence. Can I have it, please? Here is the man who's asking for the horntail horn and the beanskin bag that Helen gave you in the cellar beneath the Hawklor stables. The man who identifies him sure looks at Jewish record. I don't think this guy's Shrill. You see, this man is not who he claims to be. He also says he knows much more about Helen's disappearance than he's letting on. Nope. The man's demeanor sounds and he draws his dagger. The foreman with him draws short swords and form a circle around you. No one wastes my time, he says coldly. Cut her up. How'd I waste your time? It's not even for you. Now we're killing them. You brought me to a secret place so you can die. Blood sprays from the body of the last thug as the man's battered corpse strikes the floor. The man who introduced himself is sure to take several steps back. Crazy looks seems to come over him when it came to that upper corner of beats. He suddenly makes a break for the door. Before you can grab hold of me, name the dozens past you, blows away on a bus in the street, disappearing into the teeming crowd. Let him go. You quickly leave the building, move off into the crowded street. As you pass by the mouth of the alley, someone grabs your arm and drags you into the shadows. You find yourself face to face with a man in a leather armor, his face almost mostly obscured by a dark hood that covers his head. You'd be wise to stay away from that one, he says, his eyes continuously darting back towards the mouth of the alley as he expects trouble to arrive at any second. His name is Isk, and he's a killer. Make no mistake. You're known to me, Allison. Kenny told me to respect you. My name's Shrill. Here we go. The man moves in the mouth of the alley and peers both ways along the river docks, giving encouragement back to you. When it's not safe to talk to you, let's get further away from the street. Moves off at a rapid pace, heading deep into the alley, beckoning you to follow him. Okay. Shrill turns down a narrow alley, leaning off to the right of this one. And there he stops. When you join him, he peers at a large alley to make sure he is not followed, and he turns his attention back to you. First things first, he said, holding out his hand, giving the package to Halen, placing you in charge.
Divination.
Through the use of your power of divination, you're able to gain an insight in the man's motives. It appears that he's told you the truth about who he is, and you desperately realize the contents of the disgusting bag that Halen gave you. You do not sense he means you any harm. There you go. His face lights up as you hand him the deerskin bag that Halen gave to you. He opens the scissor that Horn took, saving inside and smiles. Well done, Allison. He says, you certainly are to the task of leading it here. You made a friend of Shrill this day, like it or not. One could hardly ask for a better friend in these parts. Shrill closes up the deerskin bag, tucks it inside the jacket of his soft leather armor. Must be off now, but take care. He says, and he steps out of the main alley. I have a feeling I'll be seeing you again, perhaps sooner than you think. I must forget. Halen promised you something, did you not? Yes, 100 more gold. She unties a leather pouch from his belt and flings a sizable object at you. When you open it, you discover it's large, it's a large amount of quantity of gold. Until we meet again, Allison. Suddenly turns and trots off down the alley and steps to the crowded street. Your wife disappears in the throng of people moving about the river docks before making your way out of the alley. Alright. So, this is the power of divination. I'm going to end the episode there. Next one, we're going to get back to Hawklor and finish up or look into more what is going on there and more quests if we can from Hawklor. And once we finish that, we're just going to move around Southwest Tisa until we've done everything we can do there and continue to move on. Maybe between cities, we'll do Proving Grounds. So thanks so much for hanging out. And, you know, until next time, you know what I'm going to say. Peace.